Hello everyone. As Ted mentioned, my name is Sohil Mehta. I am a kernel developer at Intel, and today I'm planning to talk about an exciting new technology called user interrupts. So at its core, user interrupts is just a really, really fast mechanism to do event signaling. So here are the goals that I have for today. The first thing that I'm planning to do is like provide some background or the motivation for coming up with this technology, what use cases we see this would be applicable for, and then give some overview of the software architecture and get some feedback from the community about like how this looks like and where we go from here. And feel free to interrupt me or post questions on the chat. I'll take pauses and I can answer them while we go through the presentation itself. I'm hoping this would be an interactive session. And so feel free to ask questions or provide comments. So what's the motivation for coming up with this technology, right? And so the main thing is we want to deliver events directly to user space. And doing that by bypassing the kernel. So we want really low latency, and we want user space to be directly directly receive events. Now, current existing IPC mechanisms and IO event delivery mechanisms, they have a bunch of limitations, like synchronous mechanisms like pipes or like epoll or reads, they cause you to wait, they cause you to spend a thread, and then they even cause you, like they have higher latency and they're inefficient. And like other mechanisms, asynchronous mechanisms like signals, they have even higher latency. So the only fast mechanism we have right now is polling, which is like really wasteful of the CPU. And so the idea here is to come up with a super fast and efficient alternative to these existing mechanisms. And the first implementation of this technology is in an x86 processor codenamed Sapphire Rapids. And so let's talk about what types of user interrupts are possible. So in all of this, the receiver is always expected to be a user space application. And so a user space application, similar to signals, it can receive user interrupts, and the infrastructure to receive, or at least the proposed infrastructure to receive all of this is all common. So you can, so no matter the source of the user interrupt, like the receiver has it has the same common infrastructure. And so the senders, there could be various senders who could generate user interrupts. So the first one that is currently being enabled is a user-to-user IPC. So let's say you have a process running in user space and it wants to send the signal to another process running on some other CPU. And both of them, they are running, executing some other code, and process A wants to send a signal directly to process B without going through the kernel. And so right now, so send UIPI, after doing some kernel enabling, send UIPI is a new instruction that would let them just directly send the signal without any intervention from the kernels. You just execute an instruction on user space instruction on one CPU in user space, and you get an event delivered directly to another process executing in user space. And so the RFC patches for this are out. I have provided a link below, and so feel free to review the patches, provide any comments, if you have questions, feel free to reach out as well. Now this is one source of interrupt, like a user-to-user IPC. Other source that we're thinking about is a kernel-to-user interrupt. Now let's say you have a kernel event that happens on a different CPU than the thread that is than the intended process is running on. So now the idea here is that the kernel can directly send a user interrupt to the thread that is executing in user space without causing it to exit into the kernel. And so just as part of its user mode execution, there's a switch that happens, and it gets an event, it processes that event, and then it can go back to doing whatever it was doing. Eventually, and so the patches for these are in development, and I'm hoping to post them soon after getting some initial feedback on the user API patches. Now, eventually we see this technology evolving to have other sources of interrupts. And these could be anything that can generate a kernel interrupt today, right? And so these would mean like devices or any other external sources that could generate a kernel interrupt. They could potentially generate a user interrupt, and we could deliver those events directly to user space without any device driver or any kernel entity coming in the way. And so here are the use cases that I think, or at least I think, are the relevant ones right now, and there could be a lot more in the future. And so before we go to the use cases, let's talk about how performant, like how fast is really this, right? And so there are two modes really where user APIs work. One is where you have an application that is running in user space, and it's doing its own thing, and there is an event that gets delivered to it. Now, so in this case, since we avoid context switch at both the sender side and the receiver side, so let's say a sender, it executes the send UIPI instruction, the interrupt gets delivered to another process, the receiver, and we directly receive the event. And so this is really, really fast. Now there could be, and so just user API by itself is about 9x faster than event FT, and even much more faster than pipe or signals. Now we could have another mode where the user space doesn't have anything to do, or the application doesn't have anything to do in user space, and it wants to just block in the kernel and say that, okay, if you have an event for me, just switch me back in, and this is what I'm calling it as the user API block mode. So this, as expected, has a higher latency compared to the user API running case, but even this is much faster than any of the existing mechanisms that we have right now. And so over here, the application would be context switched back, it would be scheduled back, and it would get the event, and then it can and it can act on it, and it can decide the next step of actions. And
I had a question. Is it really much faster? That looks about the same as event FD, like maybe, I don't know, 10%, 5%?
Yeah, it's 10% faster than event FD. And it's like about 40 to 60% faster than others. But yeah, this one, we don't save a lot of latency. The only latency we save is on the sender side, right? Because the sender doesn't have to go through the kernel to generate the event.
Okay.
But on the receiver side, it's the same latency because you schedule the receiver back, and there's a kernel to user transition.
Yeah.
So it's still a bit faster, but not a whole lot. And all this is like
this is the full latency, right, from sender to receiver, right? That's what you're
right. So this is actually a ping pong latency. So both of these are a ping pong latency, where from the sender to the receiver and from the receiver back to the sender, and okay, in all of these cases.
Okay.
And so it goes a full back and forth cycle. I have more details on this in the backup towards the end of the slides. Okay.
Another question, but it's okay if you want to address this later. I was just kind of curious what the use cases were, because having the user continuously running seems to be the case where it has the biggest impact. And what is the situation where a user space thread is constantly running, but also waiting for an API?
Right. So one would be where, say, if you have a worker thread that needs to, you have a thread that is doing some work, and there is some other thread that is waiting for events, and then eventually that thread would send, that thread would make the worker thread do some work. And so here the idea is your worker thread itself is doing some work, but then if there is a high priority event that comes up, or if there is something that needs immediate attention, then it gets an API, it does the processing, and it then goes back to whatever it was doing previously. Mm-hmm. So that's the general idea, and there could be different ways in which people use this. Overall, it could be a combination of like running and being blocked. And so it's a very new paradigm in terms of programming today, right? Because we don't have, it's similar to signals, but this is really fast. And we were hoping that more applications would want to use it because it cuts down on the signal latency.
Yeah, so a question that came up on the chat from Florian, which was, how does this compare to a Futex wake? Is that something you benchmarked?
Unfortunately, no, I haven't compared it with a Futex, but I can definitely work on it. I can try to gather some data and post it in the mailing list. So the performance, so let me go to the slide that has the data. So this is the benchmark that I used. It's on GitHub, publicly available, called IPC Bench. And it didn't have Futex, and so I missed comparing it with Futex. But I have provided links over here about what the enhancement is and how this, what we use to test all of this. I know it doesn't answer the question, but I can work on it and reply. We can discuss it on the mailing list. So any other questions, Ted, or was that the only one?
That's the only question on the chat.
Okay. So in terms of use cases, these are the use cases that we were thinking about. One is like just really fast inter-process communication, right? Where you just want to send data or events between two processes, and you can use this to do really fast IPC. Other usages would be like user mode schedulers, where you want to preempt threads, or you want them to act on certain events in user mode runtimes. In future, like when we have device based interrupts, these would be like for interrupt dispatch for network user space networking, where you deliver events to user space directly for these IO stacks. And do you have a question?
Yeah, I have a question. So I don't yet understand what this looks like in an application that wants to receive an event. Does it actually have to block in user space waiting for the thing, or would it jump to another instruction like in a signal handler?
That's a really good question, and I have something that comes up in a few slides. If you don't mind waiting, then we would get to that in probably 10 minutes. Like I have a sample and an example and how it looks like. Sure, so over here, like eventually for this to be useful, we would need to have like library abstractions and a lot of other abstractions to make applications use this. And so we're thinking libevent and liburing would be some of the examples. And we're just getting started with use case enabling, so we don't have any real world applications that are showing this. The only performance benchmarking that we've done is on this micro benchmark that compares these forms of IPC. And one thing that I wanted to check with all of you is if we have other suggestions for what type of applications would benefit, or what abstractions should we look at that would get the maximum benefit out of this. So I can take a pause here, and if there are suggestions, I can take them now, or you can post them on the chat and I can go through them later.
So have you thought about using this for host to guest wake-ups in a virtualization type situation, you know, like for VirtIO ring buffers sort of thing? Is that something that you've considered? I don't know if it's a good fit.
We did have a discussion about it internally, and the virtualization team at Intel has been looking at it. Unfortunately, I don't have much input on that part right now, the virtualization team at Intel is definitely looking at that use. That's the exact specific use case that you mentioned. Yeah, I'm trying to think about what was the conclusion of that, but right now it escapes me.
There's another question in the chat. I think, have you looked at using this to speed up signals or I think even event FD implementations?
Yes, I did. And so I didn't include it in the slides over here, but the RFC link for the patches, that's where I tried to describe, like I did try to go through event FD and signals, those exact two. The whole idea is, since it's a hardware based acceleration, mapping it to existing abstractions becomes very tricky, like providing backward compatibility for all of them, and like having user space have a consistent behavior across event FD and user interrupts would be tricky. And so eventually the current proposal at least has a new FD, which is very similar to event FD, but not the same. And I would talk about it in a few slides. And so maybe this is a good transition for me to go to the next slide. If there are no questions, then I can go forward. Okay, so this is the idea, or this is the software design that we're thinking about. And as I mentioned, this is quite similar to event FD. So the whole idea about this is opt-in via system calls, where a receiver thread, if it wants to accept user interrupts, it would register with the kernel, have everything set up, and then be ready to receive user interrupts. As part of the registration, it would get an user interrupt FT, which would be equivalent to an event FT. The only thing that it doesn't have is a counter. So it just gets an FT. It would share this FT with a sender, and now the sender would register. So in this case, the sender also has to register with the kernel, saying that I am a sender to this FT, and the kernel would make the connection between the receiver and the sender. As part of the registration, the sender would get a handle back. And that handle is something that it needs to use with SendUIPI. So once all the registration is done, step four, which I mentioned over here, the SendUIPI, it happens all in user space. So it's just an instruction that gets executed, and you send interrupts just from sender to the receiver executing this instruction, and there's no kernel intervention at all. And so over here, the exchange or the authentication happens through an FT-based mechanism. But then the interaction happens through x86 instructions in this case. And so overall, the sender could be a user application, it could be kernel, it could be any other device. And the example I've shown here is for a user-to-user user IPI connection, and the receiver is a user application. So this FT, the receiver could share it with some kernel entity like IOU ring, or it could share it with a device driver, and then eventually the plumbing would be made, and those agents would be able to generate events, and the receiver would be able to receive these events. Now, the idea here is it's a file descriptor based setup, and it's very similar to event FT, because event FT is currently used for some of these scenarios. And so here is what the receiver APIs would look like. These are just prototypes, and this is just like the first stab at it. And I'm sure these would change over a period of time, and the naming and the parameters. But this is, I wanted to share this over here to give you an overview of what it looks like in terms of an application. And so here you have a user interrupt handler. And so there is a function, and this exact specifics of this function would be in the next couple of slides, but it's similar to a function handler, right? So you have a special function handler, you pass it, register it the kernel using a system call called register handler, user interrupt register handler. You register it with the kernel does the plumbing. After that, each task or each process gets a set of 64 vectors. So these vectors are nothing but priorities. Like say if you have multiple events happening at the same time, then one would get priority of over another. And so you have a set from 0 to 63, and the application can choose which vector it wants to create an FT for. Let's say the application creates an FT for vector 3. And now whenever it passes this FT to any other process, whenever they generate an event, vector 3 would get triggered in the receiver. And so the receiver knows that, OK, this is the event that happened. And this is the sender that I had shared it with. And this is the event ID. So this can be used, the vector can be used as an event ID. It could be used as a priority mechanism. But that's pretty much the usage for this. And so we would share this FT using any FD sharing mechanisms. It could be like through fork or through any of the current like socket domains or bid FT, get FT, any of the existing mechanisms, you can share this FT. And any sender that has access to the user interrupt FT would be able to generate this event. So let me pause here and like if there are questions. The next set of slides talk about how the sender can generate these events. And after that, I have a sample showing how this all works. Let me check the chat to see if there are questions.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So in the case of you know, a receiver thread having multiple senders, so does that mean now the receiver thread has to go exchange this FD with all the senders? What optimizations are you looking at? I mean, how do you address
right,
that?
So, yeah. Right. So now if you have multiple, so there are a couple of optimizations that we're looking at, and I have it in the opens. And so like if you have a sender and you want to share these, say if the sender is part of the same thread or same threads or same address space, right, same MM, same process address space, then we're thinking of a way where the sender handle that we talk about. So let me transition to the next slide. So this, we have a handle that gets created when the sender registers. And this handle can be shared across all the threads within the same process address space. Now there is an argument that like if I have multiple processes and they all want to share that same handle, then how do I go about doing that? And so one of the ideas that I was thinking about is like having an FT type of representation instead of a handle. This handle right now is specific to a thread. And let me, I'll go over how these this works. But since you brought up the question, so this handle is specific to a particular task. But eventually, we're thinking we could make generalize it over like the same process address space, or it could be over like multiple, it could be shared between multiple processes.
Yeah.
It's okay if you're going to cover this later, but I'm really curious about the actual instruction level, what it takes as input. And I'm trying, wondering how you would prevent the random user space from sending a user space API to another task it shouldn't be.
Sure. Yeah, I can talk about it. So maybe there are a lot. So I have a sample that I'm planning to go through, and maybe we can talk about it that time. So here are the sender APIs, right? And the sender, so continuing from the previous slide, like the sender receives the FT through some mechanism. And now what it does is it registers itself with the kernel. So you get a user interrupt register sender, you pass the FT to the kernel. Now the kernel knows that, okay, this is the receiver, and this is where, this is how the plumbing, this is the intended receiver, and it sets up the hardware structures for this sender. And as part of the return, it sends it a user API handle. This is the handle that the sender needs to use now to generate the events for this FT. And so all the sender needs to do now is execute send UIPI and pass a user API handle. Now this send UIPI is a compiler instance intrinsic that is available in GCC 11. If you're using some older GCC, then you might have to use assembly hard coding to get this to work. But if you have GCC 11 or later, then you can directly use this compiler intrinsic and generate this event. And so this is how it looks like. Like, this is the entire sample. This is the receiver side and this is the sender side. And so on the receiver side, this is how you would define a user interrupt handler. And I apologize if this font is too small. I had to reduce it just to get it to fit on the screen. And if you're really curious, then there are a lot more samples in the RFC series that I've sent out. And there's a GitHub page where it includes a bunch of more tests. And so over here, you have a user interrupt handler. You provide an interrupt attribute. This interrupt attribute is a user space interrupt attribute. And so if you compile it with an MUINTR flag, GCC would interpret this as a user interrupt handler. And it would do all the saving and restoring of state, there's a new instruction called a UIRET instruction that allows you to return from a user interrupt handler to your execution state. So all that is done automatically by GCC. And so all you have to do is define it. This is the protot function prototype, and just define it and do your processing in this event. And so over here, the parameters you get is a user interrupt frame. This is signal similar to a signal frame that you would get. And you have a user interrupt vector. This is the same vector that the application had registered. And so now if you look at the receiver, it chooses a vector. Right now I'm choosing 0, but it could be any other vector. It registers the handler with the kernel, and then it creates an FT with vector 0. Now as part of the FT creation, it gets a user interrupt FT. And this is the instruction that is used to enable interrupt. So there is a global flag similar to the IF flag. Like on the kernel side, we have the interrupt flag that is used to enable and disable interrupts. User space can use the UIF flag. And the instruction for it is STUI, similar to the STIF instruction. And this is pretty much saying that, OK, I'm ready to receive interrupts. And the hardware knows that now it can deliver interrupts to this task. Over here, I'm using a threading example just to make FT sharing easier. But I create a pthread, and over here, it starts execution. Over here in this example, the expectation is the application would be doing some other work. Right now, since this is for demo purposes, I'm just waiting for the interrupt to be delivered. But the idea is the application could be doing some other work, or it could just spin in user space. Eventually, it can even block in the kernel, but that would increase latency. Right now, this example, it just waits. Now, on the sender side, you register a sender with the FT that it would have gotten through some means. It gets a handle, and this is the instruction that I was talking about, send UIPI and user IPI handle. And this pretty much generates this. This handler gets called. The vector 0 would get generated, and we would set user interrupt received, and we would break out of this loop, and we would exit this function. And so over here, this is the compiler instructions, and this is the sample output that you would get from this. So I'll just pause over here. This is all that I had. The next is like just feedback and questions about how do we go about enabling this feature. But I would pause about, like, I wanted to get feedback on any questions you have right now on this. And does this answer your question? Sorry, go ahead, Sean.
Yes. That's good.
Is the registration of the handler, is the handler just a thread local thing or task local thing, or is it process global?
It could be any of those, as far as I understand. So the handler, when you register and how the kernel stores it. So right now the kernel stores it as task local. Or a thread local thing. So every task that wants to receive an interrupt would have to register its own handler. And it could use the same handler, but then you need to be careful about how, if you want this to be re-entrant and how you define it. But it's up to user space. The kernel, all these registrations happen on a task-specific level, at least on the receiver side.
Okay, that means also means that I need a descriptor for every task.
A file descriptor. Right. So for every specific event that you generate, because this file descriptor would only generate interrupts for this specific event, for this specific task and this specific handler.
So now, one of the questions on the chat was, could this be used for a broadcast mechanism where there are multiple receivers? And it appears the answer is not really, because you have to have separate handles for each receiver. Is that correct?
Right. So this will definitely not work for a broadcast mechanism. If you want to do a broadcast, you would have to like pretty much iterate over all the receivers, which would kind of defeat the purpose of the broadcast. But even though like it would still be a lot faster, it would super fast. And so like the dispatch latency for this instruction is not very high. So one thing that I didn't mention earlier is this is an asynchronous mechanism, right? Where the receiver could be running, it could be, it could have interrupts disabled, it could be doing something else, it could have been context switched out just because of scheduler, like some other priority task running. And so the sender doesn't need to wait for this instruction to return. It executes this instruction and it can go ahead, and at some point this event would be delivered to the receiver when it's ready to receive it.
I'm thinking about using that to implement something like a condition variable. But given that you have to register the thing on the waiting thread, it probably doesn't really match that kind of programming model.
So the main reason we're not able to share it between processes, like similar to how you can do it for a signal handler, is because all the underlying hardware plumbing is based on a per thread MSR. And so like for the hardware to distinguish between which thread is running and which thread is not, and how to deliver those events is quite complicated. And the kernel is not involved in the fast part, right? Where you generate the event and the hardware just needs to know where to deliver this. That's the main reason we're not able to like share the receive, have a common receiver, shared pool of receivers that can receive these events.
And you need to do actual work in the kernel to set up the receive operation. So it's not something you can do once, like a condition variable wait function is called. You have to really do that upfront and to amortize the cost, right?
Right, because in this case, one is like applications might not be aware of, like they need to be compiled in a specific way to receive interrupts. And so we can't expect, like we don't know if all we can't just enable these for all applications that are not even aware of user interrupts. And so it is a registration that has to happen before to be able to bypass the kernel. Like the kernel does the authentication, it does the setup, but then the hardware needs to do the API. Now, if you include system calls at during the fast part, then this pretty much loses all the benefit that it has, right?
But would it be possible to emulate this on older hardware, so that you can use an unmodified application running this code, and then the kernel just does this by trapping the instructions?
Yeah, that's something that I actually wanted to get feedback on. So eventually other architectures or older architectures, would we want to run this on those, and then how do we go about designing this and having this compatible? Because you would have to have a special handler and you need to use special instructions. Like this call would definitely fail on older architectures. So initially, at least the idea I was thinking is if this syscall fails, then applications have a backup mechanism, like they could use event FT or any of the existing mechanisms. But I wasn't sure if that would be a good way to approach this or have like this all compatible, like everything compatible just in a slower mechanism on older architectures.
Yeah, I think both works. I would go for the emulation on x86. I think it's probably not a good idea to implement this on other architectures, because if another architecture implements something like it, it's probably not compatible. So they would have slightly different thing. They might have a different layout for the saved register structure or whatever, and then we will do it once another architecture adds this feature. But as soon as this is nailed down in the instruction set, we could easily emulate this in the kernel if we decide that's a good idea.
Right. And so the system calls, like at least right now, I've designed it based on how x86 does this. So the part that I wasn't sure about is like, do we try to make the system calls as generic as possible? But then how do we know how other architectures would go about doing this? And so we have the risk of like just kind of having other set of system calls that would be needed in the future.
So there are a couple of questions on the chat. If you wanted to take a quick look, or I can read them to you, whichever is easier.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
First question from Samrath. Can we use this mechanism to wake up a kernel module?
No. So at least so that module should be running, or it should, like, maybe yes and no. So there is a mechanism right now, at least the idea is it's a ring 3 interrupt receiving mechanism, where you would receive this interrupt when an application is executing in ring 3, and the hardware is built for that. Now at the kernel side, if you want to wake up a kernel module using this, I don't know if this is the best mechanism to do. I'm guessing there are other mechanisms that can be used to, like just a syscall or just some other mechanism. Like the main idea we're trying to do here is trying to bypass the kernel for event delivery. And so a user's, like it's a pretty much user space enabling. I don't know how this would work for waking up a kernel module.
All right, quick question from Greg. Clang support?
Not yet. So we are working on that. This is like the first thing that we got enabled is with GCC. We have internal discussions going on how to get Clang support to work on this. But I haven't tried it with Clang. Maybe Clang might have looked at how GCC has done it and try to implement the MUINTR intrinsic, but I'm not sure. I still have to check on that.
Another question from Greg. Do you have workloads in mind that will benefit from this?
So I don't have specific workloads. The one that I talked about here is like user mode schedulers are one, and just really fast IPC. But that this is one space where I'm actually looking for input. Like if there are use cases that people think would really benefit this would benefit the use cases. And this is the right phase because the first RFC is out and we can start interacting with the those users or usages to get this API right.
A question from Lucas. Can you tell me more about how this instruction works at a hardware level?
Sure. So I have a few backup slides and I can go over those. We can have a separate, I I'm not sure if we have a lot of time to cover those. I actually wanted to get some feedback on this, but we can, I can definitely go over them if we get through this slide, and I can give you some input on how the hardware works. But yeah. If you can
I should note that I did post in the chat a pointer to your patch submission. And if you go to the download link on Plumber's Linux Plumber's or Kernel Summit track for your talk, there's also a link to the lore.kernel.org of your patch. And I believe there's actually a fairly good amount of detail in the patch submission about how the instructions work. And so if you want to just simply refer people to the patches, that's fine too.
Okay.
I did kind of skim through the patch that Ted pointed us to. It still wasn't clear how we're preventing a sender from being able to send it to any other random task, and also how does it identify which CPU it needs to send it to if the task is running? And one additional question was, you said you weren't aware of the use case in mind, but I'm hoping that hardware engineers who added this instruction at least had some use case in mind.
Yeah, there are definitely use case. Like, I just don't know the exact use case where. So we are in talks with a lot of customers about where this would fit in their usages. One obvious thing is where we have user mode runtimes, right? So this could be like the Google Go runtime, like Oracle has user space, user mode threading schedulers and libraries. And so those are the places where we think this would definitely have some benefit. It's just that I don't have something enabled to show where, okay, this is the benefit that you see on a real world workload. This is still like a work in progress, and we would get there eventually. And overall, longer term, like having devices generate interrupts and delivering it to user space, user events is definitely a plus. It helps with scalability in terms of how event dispatch and processing works. But those use cases would be developed over a period of time, like much later. And so right now what we have is user to user IPC and kernel to user event notification. And the question about preventing others from sending it, that is the main reason we have this FD, right? So you have an FT that you create, and the receiver sends this FT only to tasks that it trusts. And it could be within the same process address space, or it could be across process address space to processes that it trusts. And so only senders that have access to this FT would be able to create this plumbing and would be able to use this handle.
Yeah, no, I understood at the API level. I just wondering how it's enforced at the hardware level, but.
For the hardware level, there are MSRs that this instruction would use. And those MSRs would be programmed only, and those MSRs have a table, and they have a routing to the receiver where it would only point to the accurate receiver. Now, if the task hasn't registered, or if it tries to use some invalid handle, then the hardware would complain and generate faults.
So I'm from Oracle. So we have that use case where potentially, you know, the DB is going to be doing user land threads, and that's where they're looking at users. So I'm going back to your previous slide. I'm mainly interested in this whole receiver sender association. How will this scale when you have many senders? One thought was, if you can allow the receiver to directly register into the sender's table. I know you didn't go into the implementation details so much. The sender has a table, right? UITT. And you know, the receiver doesn't have to have an FD, right? So if the receiver can directly register into the sender, and you have a common sender table with, you know, typically, you have many senders, just like in a signal and situation. you have many processes which can send a signal to any thread or process. So yeah, that needs to be, otherwise it won't scale when you have thousands of processes that you have to send your FD to.
Right. Yeah, and that is one of the ideas I had over here. Like one is the one of the opens where like a sender creates a user IPI handle. Now this handle could actually be created by the receiver itself, right? Mm-hmm. And so a receiver registers, creates this FD, it registers itself as a sender. And so this would just create like a self IPI type of mechanism. And now you have a user IPI handle that can be shared across threads of the same process. And they don't need to register themselves. They can just do a user IPI based on this handle, which is global to the address space. The idea you are suggesting could be extended to like across processes as well, where you have multiple processes and they all want to share the same sender table or the sender handle, or this handle, you want it to be global across a set of processes. And that's where I was thinking if we can have like a place or a mechanism. And so this is still an open, I was thinking like if there's an FD, just one FD, which gives you access to the whole table, where you inherit all the connections that you had previously made. And this could be like a named FD, like it could be in a named pipe or something where you can just open that pipe and you get access to all the senders, the entire sender table gets inherited. But this is still a work in development and I'm trying to figure out if there would be benefit for doing this and what would be the complications. Now, since this is a hardware level mechanism, sharing this handle across threads or across processes involves a lot, makes the kernel implementation somewhat complex, right? Because now you need to mimic changes made by one thread into changes across all the threads that are sharing that. And so when the table that you have that grows or it changes some attributes, then you need to replicate this across the threads that are using this. And so this, I'm actively investigating this, but I just wanted to get a feedback on whether this would be useful. And I'm guessing the answer is yes. It would be helpful to have this handle shared across threads and processes rather than having a per thread mechanism, right?
Yeah.
One other open that I had, so before, and I know we're getting close to the time, one is whether having this syscall and FD-based approach works. Because this, we could change the specifics of how this is defined, but one major feedback that I was looking for is whether having like a syscall and FD-based structure, is it a good idea or no? And so if anyone has comments or anyone has any feedback on the overall approach, I mean, please let me know.
File descriptors.
Yes, it would definitely help in, validating who has access rights and all that, right? If you were, let's say, if you go to the model we were discussing just now, where the sender has a table which you want to share, and if it is an FD based thing, then you can check who has access to that, and only those threads will be allowed to write into it. That might be.
If there's an opportunity to use this to implement condition variables in glibc, for instance, then the file descriptor-based approach is a problem for us because for compatibility reasons, we can't keep open the descriptor and we can't add unexpected file descriptors in the core runtime because applications, well, don't expect that. And in this case, if it turns out useful for anything in like pthread condition variables or certain types of mutexes, then we would need a different mechanism for managing the registration.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, the main reason for having a file descriptor is like, do we have inbuilt authentication mechanisms across processes? And so would there be any other mechanisms to authenticate whether like, where I want to give up, one process wants to give permission to another process to like interrupt it or do something about it, right? And so do you have suggestions on what other mechanisms would be?
I was wondering if you need that within the same address space, same process.
Right, within the same address space, we don't need to have an FT, and we could have other mechanism. But I wanted to keep it consistent between whether it's like the task is as part of the same address space, or it could be different, and have a consistent model across both of them.
Understood. Thanks.
So I had a question that related to the sharing senders across multiple processes. Can the page that contains that table be mapped? I understand that there's an MSR register that is as a pointer to the page, which is where the table is, but can that page also be mapped into a process's page table or multiple processes' page tables and then manipulated in that way or not?
Yeah, it could be. So that is definitely possible, where you have, so you can share, the sharing the memory is okay. Like you could have some abstraction for that memory, and then you share it across processes, and it could be mapped across all those. The complexity was from like where this MSR is pointing to, and we also have a place where we store the size of this table. Now, let's say the size of this table grows from 4K to 8K, and now you need to propagate that size change across all the threads that are sharing this table, and that definitely is possible, but it would add somewhat complexity into the kernel. And so I didn't want to do that unless we have users for it, or unless people want it to happen. I didn't want to add that extra complexity into the kernel. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, fair enough. Thanks. So we're almost at time, and I want to give people a quick 5-minute chance to do a stretch break. Are there any final questions?
So, sorry, Ted, just mm-hmm. Before we go, I had a final question for the group. Yeah. So right now, user interrupts don't interrupt existing system calls like sleep or read or any other processes or any other blocking system calls. And so one feedback that I wanted is whether we would want to interrupt, like say if a process is sleeping and it gets a user, if it calls asleep and it gets a user interrupt, do we want it to be interrupted? Like a signal, you break out of the syscall and you get an e-inter signal and you try to restart the syscall, like you have a SA restart type of mechanism that does the whole thing, which happens with signals. Like, do we see usages where this would matter or this would be important? Okay, I guess we can have a separate discussion for this or separate conversation over the mailing list. Ted, one other question that I had is we have interest in the hardware architecture, and so is there a possibility of getting a BOF session for this, or should I just go through a hack room and just for
the people interested? I believe all the BOF sessions have been scheduled, so probably your best bet is to grab one of the hack rooms and announce a time. You know, maybe after all the major sessions have happened, or tomorrow at some point. So I think grabbing a hack room is your best bet at this point.
Okay. Yeah, I can chat over, we can discuss this over the chat. I don't want to take up the presenter's time. So for the hack room, we can discuss it over the chat, and we can come up with the time. Thanks.